Everything you always wanted to know about home computers, but were afraid to ask. Narrated by Steve Allen and Jane Meadows. I have to confess, I've never, ever even heard about this. The idea that Steve Allen made a record about home computing. That's just so weird. This special package contains a cassette, not a record. Really? You gotta be kidding me. Oh my god! This is so weird. So they made a cassette so that they didn't have to get like vinyl pressed, and they just cut out a piece of cardboard and stuck it in. Oh my god, okay, well this is just really weird. An easy to follow instruction for families and small business includes a 16-page illustrated instruction booklet featuring computer self-quiz, practice computer keyboard with sample programs. Copyright 1983 Polygram Records. So this is Polygram Records released this, but there's no record in it. It's actually a cassette. And it is actually Polygram. Yep, Polygram Records. Everything you always wanted to know about home computers by Steve Allen and Jane Meadows.
A trip to the moon made possible by computer technology, the same technology that guides our spacecraft to the outer edges of our solar system and beyond. So, welcome to the computer age. Welcome to the 21st century.
What? It's here already? Wow, I must have overslept.
Well, no, Jane, but computers have accelerated scientific progress to the point that if you blink an eye a little too long, you may be missing out on something. And at the rate we're moving ahead, Century 21 is coming up fast, and we'd better be ready, because from all indications, it's going to be a computerized world out there.
You mean everyone is going to be using computers, hmm? But I thought that most computers were huge, expensive, complicated machines run by PhDs in white coats.
Yeah, well, that's all changed due to truly great technological advances in the past few years. Today's personal microcomputer is no larger than a small appliance. Hmm. And you definitely do not need a doctor's degree in science or math to operate one.
Good.
But you may still wear a pretty white coat if you wish.
Just think, Steve. 80 years ago, families were just getting used to the home telephone. And you know, it was only about 50 years ago that the electric refrigerator became widely used.
Mm-hmm.
And even 30 years ago, only about one family per block had a TV set. And now you
And
see,
now, Jane, microcomputers are being used everywhere. In the home, a computer may be used to store and maintain household records,
mm-hmm.
keep track of banking and financial transactions, communicate with the world, tap vast sources of information, contribute immeasurably to educational activities, provide many intellectual challenges, and a great deal of family recreation and entertainment.
Yeah.
Some experts are even predicting that the home computer will eventually replace radio, TV, newspapers, and magazines. It will, in fact, be a real window on the world, an electronic communication center like nothing we've ever seen before.
Wow. Oh, that is exciting. Well, I suppose it goes without saying that we should all start getting involved in the computer revolution.
Yes, it goes without saying, all right, but we're going to say it anyway. And that's the whole idea behind this recording. We want to make everyone aware that computers are already an important part of our lives now, and will become increasingly more so with each passing day.
Yes, and let's not forget the children, Steve, because the sooner kids get started in the world of computers, the more comfortable they'll be with them later on. Well, it's just like learning a language. It's easier if you start when you're young.
Right. And this recording will teach you some of the basics of construction, operation, and programming of computers. It'll also cover some major points to consider when you decide to shop around for a home computer. Finally, we want to convince you that computers are not mysterious and forbidding.
No.
Anyone can learn to operate one,
mm-hmm.
can learn computer programming, And furthermore, this can be learned at any age.
And in case anyone has any doubts about the importance of computers at the present time, just look around you. All banking is controlled by computers, and businesses use them for everything from farming and food processing to tax records and traffic control.
Right. Education has been streamlined by computers.
Yeah.
Doctors use them for the diagnosis and treatment of disease. Wars are fought with them. Graphics in print, motion pictures, and TV are now being created by computers. In fact, the newspaper you read and much of the mail you receive is produced by computers.
Well, I'm sold, Steve. But now, let's begin by defining precisely what a computer is.
A computer is essentially an electronic machine that can follow instructions, store and manipulate words and numbers, and make decisions based on the information and instructions it receives, and all in split seconds.
Unbelievable.
All computers, from the largest industrial type to the smallest microcomputer, have four distinct parts or sections, as you can see if you look at figure one in your instruction booklet. The first part is called the input section.
Input section.
This provides for a number of different ways of feeding information into the computer.
Such as?
Well, a typewriter keyboard, a magnetic tape, such as the kind you use in cassette players, or a magnetic disc.
Oh.
Information that's fed into the computer goes into the memory section.
Memory section.
Yes, where it's stored until needed. When this information is recalled from memory, it goes to the central processing section.
Central processing section. Well, now, that's obviously the brain of the computer, where the mathematical computations and word manipulations take place, right?
Right. Now, as this processing of inputted information occurs, the results are sent back to the memory section to be stored until called for. Now, the last part of the computer is the output section.
Output section.
It consists of one or more ways of retrieving processed information, such as a TV screen for visual display, a printer for hard copy, or a magnetic tape or disk for mass storage of information.
Now, Steve, we hear a lot about software and hardware, but it obviously doesn't refer to ladies' lingerie or things one buys in a hardware store. So what exactly does it mean?
Well, the information that's fed into the computer in the form of programs and data is called software.
Ah.
The computer itself, as well as any add-on equipment, is called hardware. As they say in the business, if you can kick it, it's hardware. Now, computer software is available in the form of cassette tape, which is fed into the computer using a common cassette player, or programs may be obtained on a magnetic disc, which is, here's that word again, inputted into the computer by means of a more efficient and more expensive disc drive.
Ah, I see. Well, now, Steve, there are some other computer terms that need explaining, such as RAM and byte. Have you ever been bitten by a RAM, Steve?
No, Jane, just by the computer bug. Now, RAM, R-A-M, stands for Random Access Memory.
Ah.
It is the memory section that the user can control. Information stored in RAM is in memory, however, only as long as the power is on to the computer, you see? Now, the contents of RAM, again, which is Random Access Memory, the contents can be cleared, emptied, and changed at will. It's like your food freezer, the contents of which are protected from loss only as long as the freezer is turned on.
Mm-hmm.
Now, just as you can buy a big freezer to store more food, you can enlarge the amount of RAM in your computer, depending on your particular needs and the limitations of your budget.
Ah. Okay. Now, what does the term byte mean?
Well, byte, which is spelled B-Y-T-E, a byte is a single character, letter, numeral, or even a blank space being stored in memory.
Ah, wait a minute. So a phrase like big dog would use up 6 bytes, huh?
No, Jane, 7. Because,
why?
Well, because of the space between the two words, you see?
I see, yeah.
Anyway, RAM is measured in bytes. Now, 1K of bytes is approximately 1,000 bytes. You can buy a microcomputer that can store anywhere from 1K to 256K bytes. But you see, the more K of RAM, the more a computer will do, and the more it'll cost.
Then we have the term ROM, R-O-M, that means read-only memory, which refers to the memory section which operates the computer, correct?
Yeah, that's it, Jane.
Thank you.
ROM, R-O-M, is available for use when the computer is turned on and is never lost or changed. It's similar to the operating system of your freezer. It's always there and ready to do its job every time the freezer is turned on. Now, when comparing computer capabilities, it's important to remember that the more ROM,
read-only memory,
the more sophisticated the operating system and the more features available to the user. Now, it's entirely possible for a computer to have a large amount of ROM and little RAM.
Hmm.
This is comparable to a small freezer with many features.
Hmm. Fascinating. Well, now, as a consumer, it's important to remember that all computers are expandable. This means that you can start with a small amount of RAM and add to it as your needs increase. It's also possible to add ROM, meaning more features, to most computers. Most arcade-type games are available as ROM cartridges.
Right.
These, you know, just plug in directly to the computer and take over as the exclusive operating system, which means when these cartridges are plugged in, the computer is a game machine only and cannot function in any other way as a computer. A very important factor to consider when purchasing a computer is its ability to be expanded in both RAM and ROM.
That's right. Another aspect of the expandability of your computer is peripheral or add-on hardware. See Figure 2 in the booklet. Now, this includes such fascinating and useful gadgetry as the cassette player, disk drive, and printer. A device known as a modem, M-O-D-E-M, hooks up your computer to the telephone. This allows your computer to talk to other computers or draw upon information stored in huge computer data banks.
It's like having a hotline to the public library. But don't forget the fun and games department, Steve. You can buy a joystick or game paddles fairly inexpensively for family fun. You might also want to invest in a light pen, which allows you to draw pictures directly on your computer's TV screen. You can also add a sound box, which is used to pick up and amplify programmed sound effects, music, and speech.
There's one last little item, Jane, that makes all of this incredible activity happen.
What's that?
It's called a chip or microprocessor chip.
Chip?
Mm-hmm. See Figure 3. Now, each of these remarkable little chips consists of millions of microscopic circuits and switches. The board inside the computer contains many of these chips, all hooked up in specialized groups to perform specific functions. For example, there are groups of chips for RAM, ROM, and processing.
Now that we've covered the anatomy of the computer, Steve, we arrive at the really important part. Just exactly what can we do with a computer?
Good question, Jane.
I thought so, too.
I was also to ask in case you forgot. Anyway, when you acquire a computer, you'll almost immediately begin searching for software, that is, programs already on tape or disk. This is important because a computer without software is like a camera without film. You'll be shopping around for programs on tape that you can load into your computer just as you would handle audio tape in a cassette player. You'll also find programs on disks that are used very much like phonograph records.
Mm-hmm. And let's not forget, Steve, that you don't have to buy all your software. You can join a club.
Right. You can indeed, since there are many user groups and organizations that offer software in quantity at practically giveaway prices, sometimes just for the cost of a blank tape.
And there's a wide range of software to choose from. You can get software to help you organize your entire household. Balance your checkbook, compute your income taxes, inventory your books and records, plan a diet, analyze your home heating usage, chart your investments, or even print out mailing labels for your Christmas cards.
And if you want to turn homework into a really enjoyable exercise for your kids, there are plenty of programs dealing with math or languages that'll turn the study hall into a game room.
Or a music room. You can obtain software that can turn the computer into an organ, and you can actually play melodies on the keyboard.
Right.
Or you can command the computer to create its own songs and play them for you.
I think you're trying to put me out of business.
No, seriously, Steve. You can even get a program that makes your computer talk in any language.
Wow, you can brush up on your Chinese.
Yes. And these programs can even teach you to speak a foreign language.
If you do a lot of typing, you can get rid of your old horse and buggy typewriter and get a word processing program for your computer. Add a printer and start to type the modern way with an ability to insert and delete words and letters, juggle sentences and paragraphs around, edit copy with the flick of a button, store what you've written on tape or disk, and print out as many copies as you need, wow, when you need them.
Honestly.
Mm-hmm.
And with a modem, you can hook up your computer to the telephone. And that means that you can communicate with computer services and data banks from which you can display and print out wire service news reports, stock market quotations, magazine and newspaper features, make instant hotel and airline reservations, and even do shopping in seconds.
And instead of giving all their allowance money to the local arcade, your kids can play the latest video games at home.
Mm.
Since many of these games are available for microcomputers on tape, disk, and ROM cartridges. These games are really challenging tests of skill and resourcefulness, and playing them actually develops excellent hand-eye coordination in youngsters.
You know, Steve, I think the best part is to learn to program the computer yourself, because you can create and design your own games, as well as many other useful functions at home, office, or whatever. You don't have to know how to program the computer in order to be actively involved in all the marvelous things we've been talking about. But your ability to program will help open whole new vistas in your computer experience.
Jane, we've now come to that moment of truth. We've made a firm decision to buy a computer.
Yeah.
This is the time now to do some serious evaluation as to the important factors to consider when you begin comparison shopping.
Yes, and the advice from most experts in the field is to start with a minimum system. You can always add components as you become more sophisticated in computer operation.
You might, for example, start with a very basic computer with just a few K of RAM. Some computers of this type are available for as little as $100. However, since most software requires a minimum of 8K RAM, you would have to beef up your basic system almost immediately for it to be of any practical use. Low-price computers utilize a flat, marked plastic sheet instead of a full-stroke typewriter keyboard. Although difficult to type on, they're designed to have individual keystrokes that substitute for full words, which constitute the computer programming commands. One possible advantage to such a keyboard is that it's more immune to such things as spills and to key damage than the regular individual key types. Are you with me, Jane?
Oh, all the way. But, Steve, personally, I might prefer to spend, let's say, $200 and get a computer with a regular typewriter keyboard and more RAM. This seems to me like a pretty good deal when you consider that prices for computers alone can run up to several thousands of dollars. These more expensive models, of course, have more RAM, more ROM, and greater expandability.
Yep. Well, RAM, ROM, and expandability notwithstanding, one way or another, you've also got to have a TV display. You know, some computers come with the TV built in, with a screen that shows up in black and white, or sometimes green and white.
That's it? No lavender or hot pink?
I was hoping you'd ask that. As a matter of fact, a color computer connected to a color TV set produces some very spectacular effects, especially with games. Now, for computers with no built-in TV, it's common practice to just hook it up to the antenna of your home TV set. A switch enables you to change from regular TV reception to computer display.
The display aspect of your computer is very important, since you're watching it constantly. But I've noticed that there's a wide range of differences in the resolution and the clarity of the display. By that I mean differences in such things as the realism of the graphics, legibility of print, size of letters on the screen, and the number of letters or characters displayed across one line of the screen.
Yes. Most commonly, displays range from 22 characters per line to 64. If you're going to do a lot of word processing on your computer, it's highly desirable to acquire a display of 80 columns.
Why?
Well, because that's the same as a typewriter line, you see.
Ah. Now, another thing you'll need is a way of storing and retrieving programs, such as a cassette player or disk drive. Some computers can use any type of cassette player, while others can only use that particular kind that's made by the computer manufacturer.
Well, so much for the basic system. Now, all of the other peripherals we've talked about can always be added later on, providing your system is expandable. Another major consideration in purchasing a computer is the availability of software. As a general rule, a computer that's new on the market will have far less software available than a unit that's been around for a while.
Ah, but now what if my computer breaks down? Is maintenance a big problem?
Happily, Jane, because computers have few moving parts, maintenance is really not much of a consideration.
Ah, good.
When your machine does need servicing, the place to contact is the service facility nearest you that's authorized by the manufacturer to repair your computer.
Well, Steve, we've covered about everything, I guess.
Yep. And it wasn't all that mysterious or complicated after all.
No. As a matter of fact, for the little bit of getting used to that's involved, when I think of all the advantages, the educational values, the intellectual stimulation, the almost unlimited practical daily applications, and all the fun and games, you know, I can hardly wait to get my hands on one.
And so you will, Jane, because that takes us into the next part. So whether you're the proud new owner of a computer or want to follow along by simulation, let's have a go at the business of putting the computer to work.
Let's. You've agreed to join the new world. You're ready to use a computer. Now, if you don't have one just now, follow along checking the illustrations in the instruction booklet, because the booklet, you see, illustrates a typical computer keyboard so that you can simulate the action.
To get started, turn the computer and the TV display on. A message appears.
Yes, see figure 4.
Stating the company name, the computer language being used, in this case BASIC, and the number of bytes of RAM, random access memory, available. Most computers also display the word ready to show that the computer is indeed ready to accept information. An arrowhead called the prompt indicates the beginning of a new line or that it's the user's turn to type in something. An underline or flashing square called a cursor shows where the next character will be typed.
And if you're new to computers...
And most of us are.
Yes, you'll probably start with tape or disk software. With so much software available, your only problem will be in choosing from the many programs on the market.
So let's now imagine that you've selected a program for a computerized date book on cassette. First, put the tape into the cassette player and rewind it. Now type in the word load and press the enter or return key. The computer responds with an instruction to press the play button on the cassette player. After you do so, the computer again responds with OK, followed by a message that it is searching the tape for the program. When the computer has found the program, it will display the word found. The computer will then load the program into the memory, displaying the word loading. When the program has been loaded, a ready will appear.
See figure 5.
Now to run the program. You type in the word run and press the enter or return key. The program is sent from the memory section of the computer to the processing section. On the TV screen will appear a listing of the options you have in using this program. This listing is called a menu.
See figure 6.
Mm-hmm. And you make a choice, just as you do with a restaurant menu.
Now, suppose we want to prepare a computerized date book. And you know, Steve, my very favorite use for the computer is the date book program.
I know, yes.
Because it creates a file of names and dates to remind you of birthdays, anniversaries, and all those other special events, you know, that we never can remember.
Yes.
You can add as many of these as you wish. And then just, you know, file them to be saved on tape, loaded into the computer when desired, and the dates recalled and displayed by any category, just like that.
The menu displayed allows for any of these options by simply entering the corresponding number of your choice. To begin using this program, you must first enter the information. To do this, press key number 1, and you'll see on the screen questions asking for the dates, names and occasions to be filed. See Figure 7.
After all your dates have been entered, we must request that the menu reappear by pressing the exclamation point key. Then, to save the file on tape for future use, press key number 3.
At some future time, when we want to be reminded of forthcoming dates and events, we load the program and choose option number 4. This will give us a screen display or printed copy of names or dates by responding to the questions displayed. For example, enter the month January and the dates from the 1st to the 31st. The screen will then display the names and dates of all the occasions listed in the file for January.
Even a reminder to have your car inspected.
Yes, that could be filed and called for.
Right.
See Figure 8. Or, as an alternative option, you could ask for a listing of all the anniversaries in the file, or you could simply enter a name and a birthday will appear. These are just a few of the many ways of using this program. Programs similar to this one can be used for a household inventory of books or phonograph records, with the ability to cross-reference by category, title, author, or composer.
Another popular type of program is the household budget. Now, when this is loaded and run, the screen displays questions about your budget. See Figure 9. You're asked to enter your income for the month, followed by variable expenses such as, well, the amount spent for food, utilities, medical expenses, clothing, and charge accounts.
I'd like to know more about your charge accounts. Anyway, your fixed expenses are then entered and made a permanent part of the program. The computer will then calculate any excess money that can go into savings or report upcoming deficits.
Mm-hmm. And this type of software is flexible and useful for any household.
Yeah, that's a great idea, Jane. When do we start it at our house?
We'll discuss it later.
All commercial software is designed for use by anyone. That is, the programs are easy to follow, the instructions are clear, and if you make an invalid entry, a mistake, you're given another chance to respond with a gentle reminder. After using commercial programs, you're now ready to make the big plunge into your own programming. Wouldn't it be nice to be able to modify these programs for your own special needs? Or, better still, to write your own original programs? Well, keep listening. It is possible, and believe it or not, it really isn't very difficult to do. Stripped of all the gobbledygook, when you get right down to it, a computer is simply nothing more than enormous numbers of switches that are contained in the chips. And like electric light switches, they can only be turned on or off. And a number system is used to operate these switches. Communication in the system is known as using the machine language. In the early days, when computers were young, this was the only way to talk with the computer. And it's still used today by many programmers because it is fast. A good example of machine language in action is the arcade-type games that are so popular.
And you know how fast they are.
Yes.
However, there's more to it than that, Steve. Because machine language is quite difficult, and certainly not for everyone, machine language translators were developed. These use English words, which are then translated by the computer into the machine language, which operates the switches. This translation process slows down computer processing a wee bit. However, when we speak of functioning times in millionths of a second, this will not be a problem for most uses.
Well, I don't know about that, Jane. These fractions of a second do add up to whatever after a while. But don't worry, folks. One of the earliest translating languages is called Fortran, F-O-R-T-R-A-N, a language in major use in the fields of science and engineering.
Mm-hmm. For business applications, a language called COBOL is used.
A relatively new language called LOGO is being used to teach young children the concepts of computer programming through graphic techniques.
In the early 1970s, a language was developed, I think this is fascinating, which is both easy to learn and useful over a wide range of applications.
And that language, called BASIC,
right,
is the communication system that's built into all personal computers.
Uh-huh. And BASIC is considered to be the universal computer language.
Mm-hmm. The nice thing about BASIC is that it uses common English words. Now, some of these words might have the same meanings in computer usage as they do in spoken language, but others will have an entirely different connotation. Beginners in programming frequently confuse the two languages, which thoroughly confuses the computer, resulting in errors. To illustrate the use of this language, let's try a basic word, print. It's used for several important purposes. Okay, turn on the computer, would you, Jane?
All right. There we go. The word ready has flashed on. So I'll type in the word print. Then I'll type in quotation marks and a word like hello and more quotation marks. And now I must press the enter key, otherwise nothing will happen. This key has two functions. It transmits the information displayed from the computer's memory section to the processor, and also returns the cursor to the beginning of a new line. Now, remember, the enter key must be pushed in order to put any information into the computer.
If you try this procedure on a computer, or simulate it using the keyboard in the booklet, you'll find that the display shows a reprinting of what was enclosed in quotation marks, as shown in Figure 10. You can order the computer to print anything exactly as it appears in quotes. A second use for print is a mathematical function. If we enter print followed by an arithmetic problem, the computer will solve the problem and display the solution.
Wow. Wish I'd had that when I was in school.
For example, try typing print followed by 2 + 3 without quotation marks and press enter. And the expected answer, 5, will appear. Now let's try some more arithmetic problems. Subtraction uses the familiar minus sign, but division uses the slash, and multiplication is accomplished by pushing the asterisk. See Figure 11.
Yeah, and you know, it probably seems silly to use a computer to add 2 + 3, but not when you realize that a computer can compute similarly higher mathematics all the way up to calculus.
All right. Now that you've come this far, perhaps you're ready for something a little more difficult. In using a computer, generally more than one instruction's needed. To compute using more than one instruction or statement, a program is needed. A computer program is defined as a series or list of instructions, statements, or steps. Each step is numbered, but the numbers begin with 10 and increase by tens.
Why?
Because that allows room to insert missing steps.
Oh, I see.
By analogy, consider a program for, let's say, baking a cake. Mm-hmm. This would be a series of instructions, each on a separate line and each line numbered. See Figure 12.
All right. Now let's develop a real computer program. This is to be a program to not only solve an arithmetic problem, but to display the problem as well. It requires more than one computer instruction.
We begin by typing the number 10. You'll notice that on the computer, zeros are slashed to differentiate them from the letter O. Now, immediately after the number 10, type an arithmetical problem. For example, again, let's say 2 + 3. Note that since this line is an instruction only to display the problem, you must be sure to enclose the problem in quotation marks. Therefore, you should have typed in 10, quote, 2 + 3, end quote, and press the enter key. The cursor goes back to the beginning of the next line, and you're now ready for line 20. This will be the instruction for the computer to solve the problem. And this time, the line will be presented as print, followed by the problem without quotation marks, so that the computer can solve the problem. Now we type in and enter 20, print, 2 + 3. The last line of the program is an end statement. Type 30, end, and press enter. There you are. Program's finished.
Mm-hmm. See Figure 13. And now we must check to be sure that the program is correct. So, type the word list without a line number and press enter. This will result in a display of the program as it's in the computer's memory. See Figure 14. Lastly, we want to do the most important thing, and that is to run the program. So, type the command run, again without a line number, and press enter. In running the program, the computer follows each line's instructions exactly. We get the problem displayed on one line and solved on the next line. See Figure 15. You have now completed your first computer program.
Yay! If you had made a programming error, the computer would not run the program. Instead, it would display a message informing you of the type of error and the line in which it occurs. For example, if you had typed print with an M instead of an N, the computer would display the message syntax error. You could then make the necessary corrections. See figure 16. Well, now that you've followed us this far, you're ready for the next step.
Mm-hmm. And that is, computer programs that do calculations use letters in place of numbers for ease of manipulation. And these letters are called variables.
Variables.
Uh-huh. For example, type in A equals 3 and press Enter. Then type in print A and press Enter. The computer would then print the value of A, or the number 3, not the letter A. See figure 17.
Okay, let's develop a program using variables. But first, if there's already a program in the computer's memory, you must type and enter the word new, N-E-W, new, which erases the contents of the computer's memory. If you want to clear the screen, press the clear button, which erases everything on the screen. To begin this new variables program, type line 10 A equals 3. The next line is 20 B equals 4. Line 30 is print A plus B. Line 40 is end.
But Steve, you must remember to press the Enter key after each line.
Correct. List the program to check it. Then type run. The computer adds the values of A and B and prints the result, 7. As you can see, this program illustrates how variables can be used in place of numbers. See figure 18.
Now let's develop a more sophisticated program. Again, using variables, but this time with a new and quite useful command called input. Now, this is to be a program to convert the familiar Fahrenheit temperatures to the corresponding but less familiar Celsius or centigrade temperature scale. In using this program, you will be asked for the Fahrenheit temperature you want to be converted. The computer will then immediately display the corresponding Celsius temperature.
Yes, see figure 19. To start the program, type line number 10, print, followed by the phrase, what Fahrenheit temperature do you want converted? Of course, in quotation marks. Line 20 is set up to respond to this question with the input statement. Type line 20, followed by input F, which stands for the Fahrenheit temperature you want converted. This temperature is entered when the program is run. Line 30 is the conversion formula, which is C equals F minus 32 enclosed in parentheses, followed by an asterisk, then 5/9. Now we'll use the variable C in printing out the Celsius temperature. We enter line 40, print, quote, Celsius equals, close quote, followed by the letter C. Enter line 50, end. List the program to check for errors. See figure 20.
Mm-hmm. Now, type run. In response to the question that appears on the screen, enter the Fahrenheit temperature that you want converted. The computer does the necessary calculations and immediately prints the corresponding Celsius temperature. This program can be run over and over for as many temperature conversions as you want.
See figure 21. Well, perhaps you now can see that this program can fairly easily be revised to convert miles to kilometers or inches to centimeters. Mm-hmm. The general formats for these programs are basically similar, requiring simple revisions. As you can see, the possibilities for problem solving are virtually unlimited.
Yes, and we suggest that you go through the development of these programs using the instruction booklet. Follow the script while referring to the illustrations, and this will help to clarify the concepts we've presented.
You're limited only by your programming expertise and imagination in having the computer do endless, wondrous things with numbers or text material. The computer has the ability to manipulate letters and words in many incredible ways, as in word processing, for example. It's a popular misconception that you have to be a math wizard to program a computer. Nothing could be further from the truth. You could spend a lifetime writing programs and not once need or use mathematics.
Exactly. And don't forget that a large percentage of computer owners know nothing about programming, yet they find endless hours of enjoyment in the use of their computers through commercial programs.
However, having a knowledge of programming will enable you to do anything from modifying existing software for your own specific needs to writing completely original programs. And the pleasure and satisfaction in these accomplishments is enormous.
Enormous. Well, there you have it. A brief introduction to the inner workings of a computer. Its simplicity of operation, its ease of programming, and its wide range of application.
So come on board. We're ready to take off into the new computer age that's going to blast us into a future that's limited only by our minds and our imaginations.